coup in Niger and the string of coups across Africa, it's literally heating up into a regional war where it's ultimately the Russians versus the West.
Hello, I'm Ed D'Agostino, and this week I speak with Dr. Pippa Malmgren. Pippa lives at the intersection of economics, geopolitics, and technology. She's a former economic advisor to President George W. Bush, an author, technology entrepreneur, and lecturer at Duke's Fuqua School of Business. Today, Pippa and I discuss a potential end to the war in the Ukraine, the possibility of conflict over Taiwan, the many conflicts across the globe that are not being reported on, and the U.S. presidential race, with a lot more in between. This has been one of my favorite episodes and one of the most important. I hope you agree. Pippa, it is so good to see you. Thank you for taking some time in your busy travel schedule to join me.
Great to see you. Thank you for having me.
I finally figured out who you remind me of.
Who?
You remind me of Bert Campaneris.
Who's Bert?
Do you know who Bert Campaneris
no.
is?
No.
I mean this as a compliment, okay. So I'll explain. Bert Campaneris was a very successful baseball player. Okay. His heyday was in the 1970s. And the reason why I say you remind me of Bert is Bert was the ultimate utility player. He literally could play any position on the diamond. And that's how I think about you. You're an economist. You're a businesswoman. You're a thought leader. You're a geopolitical analyst. You kind of can do it all. Do you sleep?
I do sleep. But by the way, there's a reason that I do this. And it's genuinely not because I'm got any superhuman qualities. It is because of my dad. And so my dad was advisor to four presidents and many heads of state. He worked for Kennedy, Johnson, Nixon, and Ford. He was one of the key people on the Cuban Missile Crisis. So effectively ended up almost as a nuclear weapons negotiator with the Russians. Nixon sent him to Moscow when he sent Kissinger to Beijing. So basically, from an early age, I had an apprenticeship from someone who was literally constantly in the Oval Office. And what my dad taught me was how to think as if you're in that room. And the thing is, in that room, you can't say, oh, I'm a Japan specialist, so I can only answer questions on Japan, or I'm a bond specialist, so I can't talk about equity. No, you have to solve the problem. So he taught me how to like see everything as if it was still my playing field, just like in baseball. Doesn't matter which job you're assigned to, we got to win the game was the mentality. And only now, as a much older person, do I really see how valuable that training was.
Yeah, I can't imagine a better mentor than Harold Malmgren. I was lucky enough to have a 15-minute cab ride with your father once, and I learned more about politics in that 15 minutes than I think I did in my political science degree.
He's totally amazing.
That's pretty neat. So let's get into U.S., and we'll start with U.S.-Russia. And I've been wanting to ask you this for weeks now. Now that the dust has settled a little bit, mm-hmm. what do you think may have really happened in Russia with regard to Prigozhin and the Wagner group and that supposed coup? Was it theater? Do we know? Will we ever know at this point?
Well, now we're talking about the new Kremlinology. And the old Kremlinology was super hard when we had the Soviet Union. This is almost impossible, even for real insiders. This is like a soap opera with a lot of different sub-stories that even the Russians may not fully understand. So I don't have a definitive view, but I can see it from a military strategic angle because of the work I do on national security issues, and I get to spend some time with NATO generals. Bottom line is, if we ignore everything else, the Wagner Group has been the private army for President Putin. And technically, private armies don't exist inside Russia. And my question is, did they just manage to move Putin's private army from Ukraine into Belarus with no one noticing? Maybe. And isn't that clever? Like, really clever to masquerade it as a coup. Now, is there a possibility of a coup as well? Yes, and there's lots of speculation now in the press that there's another one coming. Honestly, the way things always happen in Russia, whether under the Soviet Union or now, it's always been the same, which is you have a really contentious, gnarly problem of the political leadership, and everybody's frustrated. Then all of a sudden you wake up one morning and there's a new leader. Boom. It's like, oh, okay. And then you start a new conversation. When that happens, I don't know. But it sure feels like the powers that be within Russia understand that the war in Ukraine is turning out to damage, if not destroy, Russian cohesion, the Russian economy, Russian income. And no leader can withstand having all the people in pain. So, you know, you can do it for a while, but you can't do it forever. So the answer is nobody knows. But maybe a better way to think about it is, I'll just finish with this. You basically have had two different groups in Russia since the fall of the Soviet Union. You have the intelligence community, which is what Putin comes from, the old KGB turned into the FSB. They call it the Siloviki. And they have been very aligned with organized crime inside the country and outside, which is partly what Wagner Group does. And then on the other side, you have the Russian military. And the thing is, the Russian military have a very old tradition, a very proud tradition. They controlled the nuclear command, and they didn't get any benefit from Putin's being in charge. So now when he's asking them to execute on his behalf, particularly the potential for nuclear weapons, the military is like, I don't think so. So we're seeing, and that's why he had to get rid of Gerasimov, who we still don't know what happened to Gerasimov, the former head of the Russian military, who's the most respected person in that community. So it's kind of an internal fight between the intelligence community and the military community. And that's why it's so hard to get any optics on this thing.
So now we've got, as you said, the Wagner Group, troops, private military, whatever you want to call them, very well-trained organization, sitting in Belarus. And you hear a lot of talk about the Wagner Group wanting to go into Poland. So that's NATO. There seems to be a lot of narratives being floated around by both sides. And you wrote about this a little bit in your Substack, which is excellent, by the way. I was thinking, boy, this is getting bad. And you kind of had a different take on it. You said that this might be actually a sign of this might be the framework for a settlement forming, which I find really interesting. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. So to step back, well, you know, the big question is when and how does Ukraine get resolved? And so everyone tends to look at it as if it's its own freestanding piece of not a piece of a puzzle. It's just a freestanding, you know, thing that we have to address. But it's actually part of a much larger puzzle, much larger set of forces. So on the Russian side, I always think the most wonderful quote is really apt here. It came from Karl von Bismarck, who was, you know, the Iron Chancellor, and who knew more about diplomacy than anybody alive today. And he said, diplomacy is the art of building ladders for others to climb down. And that's the situation we have here, right? Is that Putin, in some ways, he has no exit from what has turned out to be a terrible situation. And so this is not about being nice to him. It's like, you know, you're dealing with a cornered, caged creature that is going to behave worse until they can find a way to escape the situation. So how do you create the circumstances for this? And also tricky, because the Ukrainian side is like, we have to win. And that means Russia must be defeated. And our military leaders keep saying, like General Milley, you know, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, Ukraine is outnumbered and outgunned. Like, it's kind of simple. I mean, you can keep this up for a while, but you may not have any Ukrainians left, in which case, what have you won? So everybody's trying to figure out, okay, how do we get both of these intractable parties to some kind of negotiating table? Now, to that end, this movement of Wagner troops to Belarus is important in a number of ways. One, I think it's about this physical location called the Sulwaki Gap. And I first wrote about the Sulwaki Gap probably, 18 months ago or something, maybe even 2 years ago, saying this is the Achilles heel of NATO. This is what Russia will really be aiming at. It's Ukraine. It's important because that was about weaponizing food prices and energy prices. Because that's another thing. Everybody thinks about this in old-fashioned military terms, that it's about tanks. And you're like, listen, babes, you can do way more damage with high oil prices to the West than you can do with a tank. And that is what has happened. So Ukraine had oil and, I mean, had, it's about oil transits and it's about food production and food transits. And it's not only Ukraine. Part of this is a North Africa story. And everybody is blind to this because they think it's just Ukraine. But Wagner Group generates most of its cash flows out of Africa. And if you look at Africa, it's just full of conflicts that, you know, Wagner and the Russians are fomenting or behind or benefiting from in some way or another. That's all about food, gold, diamonds, cash. You know, what's funding this whole thing? Answer, Africa is. Although they're increasingly also gathering recruits from Africa to use as cannon fodder in Ukraine, which is terrifying. But at any rate, so why is the Sulwaki Gap important? It's this, I believe I'm right, it's a, can't remember if it's 40 or 60 kilometer strip that would connect Belarus and Kaliningrad. Now, we have to remember, Kaliningrad is Russia, okay? It's not like a sort of friend of Russia or a former Russian. It is Russia proper. And it's this little piece that sits on the Baltic Sea.
Not connected to the rest of Russia,
to the rest of Russia. But it is as much Russia as Alaska is the United States, even though it's not physically connected. It's exactly the same, right? Belarus is basically a puppet state that the Russians effectively control. So if they can punch this little hole, and it's not very far, then not only is the whole thing connected physically, so imagine if the United States could be physically connected, move bits of Canada out of the way, right? That would make the United States look very different. Also, the thing is, with having nuclear weapons in both Kaliningrad and Belarus, which now appears to be the case, right, you are in the heart of NATO. Plus, who would suffer if you punch that hole? Answer, the Baltic states would be cut off. So Estonia, Lithuania, Latvia would literally be at the mercy of Russia, which is why they are so nervous. Why Lithuania is reviving its ancient relationship with Poland, which used to be an empire in the past. So this is a very strategic move to threaten the Sulwaki Gap. And again, does it have to be like it was in Georgia, where Russian tanks roll into the gap? Which is, by the way, just so we're clear, it's a road. Okay. Do the Russian tanks roll into the road? No. But you know what? You only need a couple of trucks to have accidents and suddenly no traffic is moving. And are there a whole bunch of people who are actually Wagner employees who are now controlling the space? Yes. And does it become a way you can move in and out of these two countries and move stuff between them without anybody having any oversight? Yes. So, you know, we're in an era where warfare is not played above board anymore. We're in an era where both Russia and China talk about unrestricted warfare, you know, a world where everything can be weaponized, take off the uniform, put on the other side's uniform, like anything goes. And so, by moving in this direction, it's made NATO realize we need to resolve the situation in Ukraine. Because if we don't, the problem is the Poles and the Lithuanians have a much more aggressive view. So they're like, if they come within the Sulwaki Gap, that's it. We're not waiting for NATO. We're just going to take action ourselves. And remember, Poland is about to have the largest military in Western Europe. They will be the largest military power of this region. And they're like, we've seen this movie before and we know how it ends and you can't give an inch. They'll take a mile. So I keep saying Washington is in some ways more afraid of Poland than Russia. Because we could cut a deal maybe with the Russians, but the Poles might not accept it. And the Poles will be like, forget that. Our territorial integrity is at stake and the Baltic states are at risk. And we're not going to wait for you guys to get brave enough to deal with this directly. So that's like one layer of this onion. And then I would throw in as well, Taiwan. And I was just in Romania, actually, about a week ago, meeting with some members of their cabinet, a bunch of their parliamentarians. And you would think Romania is right next door, that they are very focused on this. And when I said, you know, this also has to do with China. And they were like, what are you talking about? It has nothing to do with China. And I'm like, it does, because China and Xi Jinping has made it clear that he is now going to be a peace broker because he's told Putin every time he threatens nuclear weapons, within an hour, the Chinese come out and say, truce, constructive talks, no nukes. And so that allows us to align with China on the how do we get the situation under control. So China's like trying to play the good guy, but they're like, okay, but we have a price. And the price is we want some certainty on Taiwan. And by the way, some other stuff. We got a list. And so if you notice, a couple of weeks ago, the Canadian foreign minister came out and said, if the worst case scenario for Taiwan is to look like Hong Kong, we can't go to war over that. And you're like, whoa, are we agreeing to do some kind of a deal? And maybe for Taiwan, it's 100 years instead of 25 years. You know, maybe there'll be all kinds of bits and pieces that are a little bit better. But it all amounts to the Taiwanese taking the position, do we want to be another Ukraine? Maybe not. And Xi taking advantage of this Ukraine action to then try to negotiate and navigate a deal where he gets to be the superhero because, number one, he gets Putin to stop and Ukraine to end. And number two, because he gets to keep a whole bunch of things that are on his list. And so I think, look, this is very Chinese. They play a clever and long game. They're smart. And this is multidimensional chess.
I was going to ask you about Taiwan. I have a hard time seeing Americans get behind two Ukraines, right? Yeah. Especially in Asia. I just don't see Americans rallying around a location that's so, I think, foreign to them.
Yeah.
Right or wrong, I wonder, would the support be there? And then even if it is, can we afford a second Ukraine in terms of what our military capacity is and our checkbook?
Now you're sounding like Robert F. Kennedy in the presidential race, because that's his argument. Uh-oh. As well. So you're right. And what is fascinating to me about Taiwan and Asia is, so first of all, when I lived in Hong Kong, I ran an asset management business for Bankers Trust for all of Asia. And so I spent a lot of time in Taiwan. And I always was struck that the Chinese capital controls, which meant that you could build a factory in China, like, let's say, a Heineken beer factory, and you could make a ton of money there, but you could never take your money out because it's not convertible, right? And you would say, but I made a ton of money, I'd like to take it out. And they said, no, we think you should build another factory. And you would say, no, but I'm done. I don't need another factory. Well, we think maybe you didn't file your taxes correctly last year, and this could be problematic for your staff. And you're like, maybe we need another factory in China, right? So this is kind of the game. With one exception, what is the one nationality they allowed them to take all their money out? Taiwan. So why? Because they were buying the whole middle class. And so everybody who's made money in Taiwan has principally made it in China. And so what is the real appetite in Taiwan for not just independence, because there's a high appetite for independence, but what's the appetite for fought for independence, for a militarily fought for independence? The answer is not as high. And notice that the former chief executive of TSMC, the big Taiwanese computer chip company, recently stepped forward and said, I'd like to be candidate for president, and I would run on a platform of let's cut a deal with the Chinese because we don't want to be razed to the ground, and let's figure out an accommodation between us. And by the way, meanwhile, I do think there's an active strategy that the U.S. is literally airlifting the most valuable parts of the semiconductor production in Taiwan, which are mainly those Dutch lithography machines, which cost like 250 grand each, I think. And they're moving them to Texas and Arizona. And they're moving the families because you need a certain amount of skill to operate these things. There have been lots in the press in the United States about we don't have the skills to make super, you know, edgy semiconductors. Yeah, but the Taiwanese know how to do this. And those families are like, great, I'll just become American. How fabulous. So what is there left to fight over in Taiwan? And by the way, as an aside, I also see semiconductor production moving into space. We're going to have in-orbit manufacturing that produces much higher grade computer chips at a lower cost. We can come to that in the space sector. But in other words, the dependence on Taiwan for that is diminishing every day. So what would most wrong foot the United States is if the Taiwanese themselves said, let's cut a deal, because then we can't do anything. Now, in the meantime, one of the biggest issues we have, and I agree with General Milley on this, he has publicly said we have an underreported massive military buildup occurring in the Pacific. And we do on both sides. It is separate from, though related to, Taiwan. But it's about the Chinese have these super dredgers where they're creating what they call unsinkable aircraft carriers. They can literally create an island that is, you know, reinforced with military capability in a matter of weeks. And so they're creating new fortifications in the ocean, in the Pacific. The U.S. is building a massive new Guam, which is just slightly south on a little island called Tinian. And it's part of a massive upgrade to American offensive and defensive capabilities in the Pacific, because we're worried that Guam, what if it gets hit? What else have we got? Now we're creating a second one with vastly more capacity for more capability. And then there's this whole thing between the U.S. and China of deepening relations with all these little tiny Pacific islands that mostly people have only heard of if they like scuba diving, right? They seem so obscure and remote to most people. The Solomon Islands, the Truk Islands, but all these places, they're having to choose. Am I going to align with the Americans or am I align with the Chinese? Am I going to build a Chinese military base or an American military base? So that is definitely happening. And the fear that we might end up in a real military conflict between China and the United States is also compelling everybody to come to the negotiating table over Ukraine. Because if we can get that sorted out and we can agree on the future of Taiwan, then maybe we don't need this massive buildup. Because then the question is, can you really have that much stuff ready to go and not use it?
As Americans, we hear about, in the broader media, we hear about Russia and Ukraine. We hear about Taiwan. I'm curious, what is your top geopolitical concern? Is it one of those, or is it something that is buried on page 20?
For me, it's about understanding this three-dimensional chess game. And so what are the pieces of the puzzle that are meaningful within that chess game? So, you know, I've been describing this, and you mentioned it earlier, as we're already in World War III. And that freaks everyone out when I say it. And I said it, I think, first 2 years ago or so. People are like, this is crazy. No, we're not. I'm like, yeah, we are. And there are more countries involved than there were at the beginning of World War II. But it's an invisible war. And why is it invisible? When I talk to the editors of the major newspapers, you know, particularly in the UK, I'm like, why do you only report the war in Ukraine? Why don't you report all these other very important events that are occurring in other places, which I'll walk you through? And they say, well, it's the old rule. If it bleeds, it leads. So we have dead humans and injured and displaced humans in Ukraine. That's a human interest story. So we can, and it's visual. We can send the reporters and they can show the devastation. Okay, but these other things are just as important. So as some examples, I've basically said we're in a hot war in cold places. Now, those cold places are space, the Arctic, and the high north. People are like, what do you mean we're at war in space? I'm like, well, okay. So let's remember we live in a GPS world, right? And so we're completely dependent on satellites for not only missile guidance, but frankly, Uber Eats, right? None of this happens.
Sure. And how to get from here to New York. Yeah, I mean, like, no, nobody can do it anymore.
We shut down if we don't have that. So what's been happening in space, which is we're in a proper space race now, right? There's a race to establish the first physical foothold on the moon that will be manned. I'm actually making a documentary about this right now, the new space race. And I go into the reasons why, but we'll come back to that in a moment. The main thing is it's kind of the new commanding heights. If you have control of higher orbits and the moon, you can basically take out everybody's satellites from above. So what's been happening in space? The Russians have been targeting their own satellites, particularly the really big ones that weigh like 4,000 pounds, smashing them to smithereens, creating this huge debris field, which they call a Kessler effect, which has been described as razor blades in a washing machine. And that is partly what has forced the International Space Station to nearly evacuate on a few occasions, because they're getting caught in the shrapnel field that the Russians created. Now, why did they do it? Because they're trying to deny access to those critical orbits. So it's a denial of access, just almost like a cyber attack is in cyberspace. This is a physical orbital denial of service attack, in a sense. The Chinese have also been very active in space, demonstrating they have lasers and all kinds of offensive capabilities. But two things there. One is only the United States and China have satellites with robotic arms. And the Chinese recently demonstrated with, I believe it's called the Shijian 17 satellite, that it was able to go up to a Chinese satellite, grab it with the robotic arms, and then hurl it into outer space. Now, why are they hurling their own satellite into outer space? To show us that they can. And so we're like, right. Oh boy, all our satellites that we depend on could be gone in a heartbeat and never to recover into the depths of space. So this is space wars. Wow. Also, remember Starlink, which is our main, you know, internet network, satellite internet network now. Starlink has been supplying services to Ukraine. And so the Chinese said, hey, wait a minute. Starlink is therefore a military company providing military support services. And Elon went, no, we're not. We're just providing it for humanitarian reasons. And the Chinese went, no, because the Ukrainians are using it for offensive operations, which it seems they were. So he turned the bandwidth down, or I don't know what the technical term is, but he made it less possible. The Ukrainians started having a heart attack going, no, we need this to fight the war. And Elon goes to China, where he's received, you know, very well by the Chinese authorities, because he wants to protect both Starlink and Tesla. Because why? The Chinese said, well, we're going to create a mega constellation of satellites of our own, but ours will be armed and they will be capable of either interrupting or damaging or destroying all the Starlink satellites. So we're going to weaponize our mega constellations. Now we're talking about mega constellations of satellites being weaponized. Now, by the way, there's some technical difficulties with that, because some of these satellites are literally the size of a shoebox, right? They're so small. And that's what makes them robust, is that you can't find them to take them out. But nonetheless, we are talking about war in space. Now, people, again, they're like shrugging their shoulders. Well, what does this mean for me? Well, it means your GPS might not work tomorrow. But it also has led to a fight over subsea internet cables. And the first cable cut was in, it was on January, it's actually technically January 6th, 2020, which is a very interesting day for other reasons. And nobody connects the dots on this thing. But the fastest internet cable in the world is on a little island in the Arctic called Svalbard in Norway. Now, why is it there, of all places? Because that is where pretty much all the high-altitude satellites connect to Earth, is at Svalbard. So you cut that cable, and suddenly your missile guidance system's not working, and your Uber Eats isn't either. So how much damage can you do to the world? Answer, a huge amount. But luckily, that was a lot of redundancy already built in. So somebody basically, it's such a wonderful story. It's so interesting. There was an oligarch yacht positioned over the top of the cable. And that yacht had a submarine inside it. But they think that, and I'll just say, we don't know who did this, right? And nobody wants to acknowledge who did it. But somebody's submarines went underneath it. And they cut away, I think it was 6.5 kilometers of, and I've lived in Europe so long, I forget what that is in miles. Was that like 5 miles of cable, 4 months? Yes. They cut it and took it away. So it's not like, oh, it hit a rock and it broke. No, no, no. Somebody cut it at both ends and took it away. Luckily, it was redundant. But it was the opening salvo, to my mind, of World War III. And that's when the British Chief of the Defense Forces, Sir Tony Radakin, who is, you know, I've a very sober, thoughtful, considered military leader, came out and said, this is effectively an act of war. It was like in the Daily Mail, which is the most, you know, viewed written publication in the world. And then it just all disappeared. Why did it all just disappear? Because nobody wanted to say that Russia and the United States were directly in war, because that is just a very, the threat that you go nuclear threat, like nobody wants to be there. So basically, suddenly everybody just dropped it. Nobody wanted to discuss it. And so it went away. But since then, we've had all kinds of attacks on the subsea internet cables all over the world. And again, if you Google this, you'll see it. The Marseille cable, the main cable that connects the United States with Europe and Asia. More recently, the cable between the Shetland Islands and the Faroe Islands. So between Scotland and the Danish Faroe Islands. And everybody's like, who cares? It's a bunch of sheep and goats, you know, that live on these little islands. Yes. But this is also the exact passageway where we track whether Russian submarines are coming into the Atlantic with or without nuclear weapons. So you want to have that internet cable live, because without it, you have no visibility on this at a time when Russia is threatening to use nuclear weapons. So this is what I mean. There's this invisible war that it's there if you look for it. But because no one's given you the overarching narrative of this World War III happening in these spaces in these ways, most people just don't even see it. And then that's just the hot war in cold places. I've also said we're in a cold war in hot places, which is what I've described in the Pacific and Africa. And I'm about to do a piece talking about the hot war in hot places, because now the coup in Niger and the string of coups across Africa, it's literally heating up into a regional war where it's ultimately the Russians versus the West. It's just no one wants to acknowledge that it's that direct, but that is effectively what's happening. And we've increased our special ops presence in these parts of Africa very dramatically in recent years, precisely because of this.
And you haven't even gotten into some of the other things that that I look at, like the weaponization of social media. Yes. Last week, I spoke with Allison Federica from Geopolitical Futures about China's unofficial policy of exporting input materials for fentanyl, which then finds its way into the U.S. Man, You know, I really get nervous about how digital our lives have become. It just feels like such a huge vulnerability.
Well, it is.
Andy Greenberg came on the podcast. He's an author and he's a writer at Wired magazine, which is one of my favorite publications. Mm. And he wrote a book called Sandworm about Russia's cyber attacks against Ukraine years ago. Mm-hmm. And it was one of the things I found most interesting was in Ukraine at the time, I don't know if this is still true or not, but the post office was the primary way for people to access cash and make payments. And if they were behind on digitization, and thank God they were, because their paper backup is what saved them and allowed everyone to be able to make payments and get cash and get access to food. Boy, what a huge vulnerability we've created for ourselves.
Yeah, but my understanding is that the technological innovation that's underway is so mind-blowing. Everywhere I look, I see things that really seem science fiction, but they're not. They're science fact. And one of them is there is a replacement for GPS. And so we will be able to function without the satellites. And so it's not fully up and running or into place, but it's coming. That's super interesting. But otherwise, yes, the digitization of society, which is a subject I've been interested in literally since the beginning of my career. In fact, the very first article that I ever published was in, and now I'm like totally dating myself, 1984, in a journal called Telematics and Informatics. And it was about the digitization of intellectual property. So I was working for the US Trade Representative, and the question was, how do you tax like a turnkey factory? If you see, you know, a company in the United States, let's say, I don't know, a Bechtel, create a turnkey factory and sell it to, I don't know, Poland, then there's a tax, right? A duty that you can apply on that. What happens if it's just blueprints you send with one keystroke? Where do you tax it? Like, what's the point of transaction? Where is the value in that digitized factory? And this has been a huge issue I've tried to understand for literally decades. And we're no closer to having a good answer to that question. And then there's the practical matters of how life functions when your digital world is interrupted in any way.
And how do you regulate it, right? I mean, that's something that we seem to be far behind the eight ball on. We were behind the eight ball. We still are on social media. Mm-hmm. And now AI is all the rage. And I can't imagine we'll be any better at regulating that.
Well, and now we're in, like I said, this new space race. Mm-hmm. And the move into the space economy, one piece of that puzzle is, guess what? There are no regulators in space. And so part of the reason you're seeing, it's not the only driver, but one piece of the puzzle there is that you can create things in space where there is no regulator, no oversight. So the first space factory has just gone up and they are manufacturing pharmaceuticals. And you're like, wait, what? Again, the answer is, well, first of all, it turns out that some pharmaceutical ingredients won't combine in a gravity environment, but they will in a zero gravity environment. So you can make things there that you can't make on Earth, but also no FDA. And you can then drop that in the ocean. And somebody who says, I really need a drug that does this particular thing, and I can't wait for the regulators to go do all the testing and da-da-da-da-da, and I can afford to pay, you can make stuff for that audience in space, drop it in the ocean, they can pick it up. It sounds like a big rigmarole, but, you know, movement between Earth and space is no longer such a big expensive deal as it used to be.
We've talked about all these kind of scary things, activities. What's interesting is, you know, I think about who wants this, right? Or who doesn't want this, right? And I suspect that a broad swath of the citizens of the world don't want this.
Yeah.
Their lives aren't going to be made better by less global trade.
No.
Their lives aren't going to be made better by armed or alternative forms of conflict. Yeah. It kind of gets into the something I really wanted to make sure I discussed with you, which is just sort of the general mood of this country in, and especially with relation to Washington, D.C. Yeah. The last time you and I were together face to face was probably 6 or 7 years ago. Yeah. We were at a conference. And we were chatting off to the side, and that was back when House of Cards was really popular, that show. And Kevin Spacey's character, I think the night before, had shoved a reporter in front of a train. It was just really dark interpretation of what was going on in D.C. And I'll never forget this. I asked you, I said, you've been in D.C., you've worked in D.C. at the highest levels. Is it really that bad? And you said, no. And then you said, it's worse. But if they showed the American public how bad it really was in Washington, D.C., no one would believe it.
Yes.
Which I just, 7 years, I still remember you saying that verbatim.
Yes, so
what is your take today on the mood in this country and Washington, D.C. in general?
Yeah, you know, I sat next to the original author of House of Cards at a dinner party.
Wow.
And I said to him, I think you're holding back. He said, you must be from Washington, D.C. I said, I am. He said, then you know that I am. Even if you told people, they just wouldn't believe it. But in a way, why? I mean, there's so much at stake, right? I mean, people do crazy things when there's so much at stake. Politics is a blood sport. It's a very tough game. I was in it for a period of time, but it's hardball. So where are we now? Well, so, you know, in the past, I've been writing about this concept of the social contract and that there's always a social contract. And that social contract is breaking down for principally because of the debt burden. And that's not just true in the U.S. That's true in many parts of the world, all of Europe, the U.K., frankly, China. So if you think about the debt burden as like a wrecking ball, a heavy weight that bears down on the social fabric, and it basically breaks the promises that have been made. The promises may be different in different locations. In China, the promise was you'll get rich before you get old. Well, nobody believes this anymore. They did, and they were willing to work in horrific conditions in factories, you know, move from the countryside into the city for the chance, just the chance to be rich before you got old, but it's not paying off. And so this is again why we see, you know, protest movements in China, although they're squelched so fast, it's hard to get a grip on them. But things like the white paper movement, where people were just holding up a blank piece of paper because you can't say anything, you can't write anything without basically being arrested and disappearing forever. So just the piece of paper was like the signal that you're protesting. And frankly, that movement got squelched as well. Again, I mentioned earlier the young people who are having photos on Instagram of them lying in the street prostrate because they're like, I've done everything by the book and there's no job, there's no income, there's no better life. Like, what is wrong with the system? So it's not just the U.S., but in the U.S., we've definitely reached a point where people are they're angry, they're confused, they're overwhelmed by technological change. You talked about the digital space, and there is a war in that space. It's a war by, you know, all those social media platforms for our attention. And, you know, for those who saw The Social Dilemma, I thought it was so super fascinating, you know, all these super brilliant algorithm experts who built all the algorithms on Instagram based on gambling algorithms in Las Vegas, right? To get you to just keep hitting the slot button.
The dopamine hit.
The dopamine hit, right? And now they've left and they have kids are like, you know, it's really bad what it does and I don't let my kids use it. And you're like, Did you not recognize this when you were building these things? But look at Dean Hinton, the godfather, grandfather of AI. Same thing. He did an interview recently where he went, I'm really worried about AI. And the interviewer said, but you built it. And he goes, well, yeah, because, you know, someone had to get there first and it was a big prize. But now that I've got the prize and I've made my money, I'm kind of worried about it. And you're like, you really?
Gee, thanks.
Yeah. So, okay. But this is part of a separate problem, which I'm really interested in, which is that we have innovation. We have innovators who are more interested in the winning and the money than in the social consequences. And that is its own conversation about, do we have to have it set up that way? Is that a necessarily inherent part of the way capitalism has to work? I don't think it is, but that's a different story. So anyway, the weaponization of the media space has created a lot of jangliness in the public dialogue. So everybody doesn't, every time I give a speech in the States, I get half the audience comes up and, well, basically everyone in the audience comes up and says, I can't talk to the other half of America. I literally can't have a conversation with them anymore. And you're like, okay, but that means 100% of the audience are thinking either you agree with me or you must be evil or stupid. And I'm like, this is no way to begin a conversation. Like, you know, part of what we have to do is repair the public dialogue, because you can't have civil society if you don't have civil dialogue, which, again, I think it's super interesting. The one presidential candidate, which I'll come to the presidential race, who is saying this is Robert F. Kennedy. And I watched Piers Morgan, who I know. And Piers in person is a very thoughtful man. But he started pummeling RFK. You go on Fox News and you talk to those Republicans and you have a conversation with Trump. And aren't you ashamed of yourself because you're a Democrat? And RFK said, how are you going to persuade your opponents if you don't speak to them? Really simple, but right. And so partly what we have to do is create space for conversation where we don't enter with certainty that I'm already right and you're already wrong. And this is very difficult to do, but I think it is possible. But it's underpinning a lot of what's happening in the public space today and why everybody's so shut down. And it's, they're like, I can't even talk to the other side. So we have to break that somehow. And I'm fundamentally, I'll finish with this. I am very optimistic about the world economy of tomorrow. I see so many new jobs being created, so much innovation that's going to make our lives easier and better. I think the biggest constraint on the future is, number one, we refuse to take advantage of the free time that we're given because we're so ego-driven. We're like, no, but I still have to be the richest. I still have to have more cars than my next door neighbor, or bigger cars, or more expensive cars, or more famous cars, or I don't know. I still am in the more, I win, you lose mentality. So even when things make your job pop, that you could do it in a few hours a day, you're like, no, I have to keep, you know, ahead of the other crowd. That mentality is literally killing everybody. And if we could get a little more, and I know it sounds so woo-woo, but a little more heart-aligned, we could do what John Maynard Keynes suggested, what, 80 years ago, in a wonderful piece, which everyone should reread now, called, I think it's A Letter to My Grandchildren. And in it, he says, all these innovations are coming and you're only going to have to work like 15 hours a week and have an amazing life. Well, why hasn't that happened? Because we won't allow it to happen. We keep wanting to still make more money and have more stuff. So that's a human problem that can be solved. Second, our most undervalued asset in the world economy are people. And we have this industrial revolution mentality that you have to have a certain degree and you have to have a certain title. You have to have certain job skills in order to do certain things, which is simply not true. And people are capable of extraordinary things. And if we stop saying, oh, well, you know, that group of people can never be educated, they will never improve their skills, they will never be incentivized to take advantage of new technologies, I just call BS on that. No, I think that we continue to treat people as if, unless they fall into the system in lockstep, then we go, they're a waste of time. And I just don't think it's true. And even the people who are in the lockstep, we are missing so many wonderful capabilities they have because we don't allow them any time or space to explore them. So I'm all for, we have squashed creativity at the expense of saying analytics is everything. And my view is if we shifted and said, well, actually your creative and imaginal skills are the key to the economy of tomorrow, and you don't need to be as analytically strong anymore because, frankly, technology is doing a lot of that for us these days. So all of that gives me immense optimism about the future, which, by the way, last thing I'll just say on this, I have been arguing all through COVID that we're not going to go into recession. And all the big institutions, the big banks all said, we're going to have a recession. It's going to be appalling. And I noticed JP Morgan and all these other banks this last week all lifted their recession call. And I'm like, right, because it actually was like wiping the slate clean and letting people get rid of broken business models and start again with better business models. And it shows.
Yeah, and the rise in interest rates is going to clean out some of the, we hear all the time about these zombie companies. You know, they can exist and pay their debt if their debt isn't too much, but they really aren't profitable. And they're just kind of
now they're
out there ruining it for everybody else, right? and they'll get cleaned out. And that's not a bad thing.
It's painful, but it's survivable. Nobody likes being told to go get on the running machine with a rising incline, which is what higher interest rates are, when they've been feeding on free donuts, which is what quantitative easing was, right? They're like, no, I like the free donuts and not having to go to work. Okay, yeah, but you'll live longer, you'll be healthier if you get on the running machine.
You kind of touched on capitalism in some different ways. And that mentality of winner take all and more, more, more. It kind of goes to what I think a lot of people are feeling in this country. And before we started, you mentioned it's not just here. It's this feeling that the deck is stacked against you, right? Like if you do everything, you said it before about China, like I did everything that I was supposed to do. I got a degree or I finished school or I work hard every day. You know, I take care of my family. I do all those things. And yet I just can't get ahead, or every month I'm trying to figure out how to pay that last bill. I feel like this is coming to a head. Some of what was happening in this country politically, where you had far left and far right people, I'm going to try to thread the needle on this, but you had one side not understanding the other. And I almost feel like that was a distraction put out on purpose by the political class, if you will. I've abandoned the idea of there being this real left versus right divide. I'm sure there is to some extent, but I feel like the bigger divide is really those with political power and everybody else, all the rest of us. There was a song released last week by a little known singer in West Virginia named Oliver Anthony. And this guy, you know, he was doing his thing, right? He was putting out, he's an artist. He's putting his music out on YouTube and getting, you know, maybe a few hundred views. Then he released a song that I want to play for you because I really want to know what you think. Because this song, last time I looked, after having been posted for 8 days on YouTube, had already achieved 12 million views. I'm sure it's way higher even as I speak. But it, like, I think this guy nails really what a lot of people are thinking. So if you've got a minute, yeah, let's check it out.
I've been selling my soul, working all day, overtime hours for bullshit pay, so I can sit out here and waste my life away. Drag back home and drown my troubles away. It's a damn shame what the world's gotten to for people like me, people like you. Wish I could just wake up and it not be true, but it is. Oh, it is. Living living in the new world with an old soul. These rich men north of Richmond, Lord knows they all just wanna have total control. Wanna know what you think, wanna know what you do, and they don't think you know, but I know that you do. 'Cause your dollar ain't shit, and it's taxed to no end. Politicians look out for miners, and not just miners on an island somewhere. Lord, we got folks in the street, ain't got nothing to heat, and the obese milking welfare. Well, God, if you're 5'3" and you're 300 pounds, taxes ought not to pay for your bags of fudge rounds. Young men are putting themselves 6 feet in the ground, 'cause all this damn country does is keep on kicking them down. Lord, it's a damn shame what the world's gotten to for people like me, people like you. Wish I could just wake up and it not be true, but it is. Oh, it is. Living in the new world with an old soul. These rich men know the rich men. Wanna know what you do, and they don't think you know, but I know that you do, 'cause your dollar ain't shit, and it's taxed to no end, 'cause the rich men, north of Richmond. Selling my soul, working all day, overtime hours for bullshit pay.
Amazing.
Richmond, north of Richmond. I mean, it is exploding in popularity. And you know, when the UPS driver that pulls up in front of your house every week, mm-hmm. Sweating and working his tail off, and drops a package on your door, and he pays more as a percentage of taxes than your average hedge fund manager, or as a percent of his income in taxes, yeah. Because capital gains are taxed at a much lower rate than work. I mean, I think people are fed up. What do you think?
So this is so powerful. I've got so many different things to say. The first one is, it's very important to follow the artists. I agree with Ezra Pound, the poet, and Marshall McLuhan, the very brilliant writer. They both said artists are the antenna, the early warning system, the radar of society. And I think this is true. So I'm not surprised that the artists are telling us where the pain is. Second, this is a statement about inflation. And again, when I wrote my book Signals back in like 2016, and I said something very simple. I said the bailout of the financial institutions in the financial crisis is going to bring back inflation and cause geopolitics to reappear. And everybody said, that's crazy. Inflation is dead. It's never coming back. Remember those days when everybody said inflation was dead? And I'm like, listen, as an economist, I'm telling you, when you throw free money in the system and you drop interest rates to zero, the only purpose is to create inflation. And the Fed is saying that they can control the outcome even as they deny they're doing it. And I'm like, but Paul Volcker has told us, and history tells us, you can't control the outcome. So you think you have control that you don't have. And so today, where is the Fed on this? Well, Ben Bernanke got a Nobel Prize for bailing out the financial markets. inflation has come back, and the Fed says now their view is, oh, this is completely exogenous. This has nothing to do with interest rates or, you know, how much money we print. And you're like, really, what planet are we on, guys? It's a total function of the fact that you made this choice, because their fear at the time was that the price, the cost of not bailing out the financial markets would be that we'd be in another 1929, a horrific, terrible crash. But they didn't spell out that the flip side of that is instead we're moving the burden from the wealthy to the poor, because inflation always hits the poor much harder. So when our singer here, our wonderful artist, says, he talks at one point, he sings about being overweight and eating fudge. And this is really important, because when the price of food goes up, and by the way, parentheses, Putin was completely aware that we already had inflation in motion. It made sense to hit America with much higher food prices at that moment. Normally, it wouldn't matter because we produce so much food of our own. But in this moment in history, they could create a lot of pain for Americans. And so what happens is when food prices go up, the wealthy can afford the higher prices. They may complain about it, but they can pay. But the poor cannot. And the cheaper calories are always emptier calories. And so the rise in obesity is a reflection of poverty. So ironically, heavier weight is a function of greater poverty. And so this is splitting our society between the wealthy and the poor very profoundly. And it's one of the reasons why historically central banks prize and protect this concept of price stability. Because what that really means is that it's like a balance in terms of justice. And you should be keeping the balance of interest between the savers and the speculators. But what we did is we tipped the balance in favor of the speculators at the expense of the savers. And the savers are now feeling it, or the people who don't have any savings. They feel it in the form of, wait a minute, I'm working this hard, but I can't feed my family. And this is what gives rise to Trumpism. It's what gives rise to the geopolitical fight, because no place hurts faster from inflation than China or emerging markets, right? Inflation hits the poor really hard and really fast. And this is, again, to go just a little more detail on this, because our audience, we got a lot of traders and hedge fund managers, and they'll say, oh, you were wrong, because inflation didn't come until a decade later. And I'm like, no, 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 no. We went from zero, pretty much zero inflation around 2014, 15 to 3% before Ukraine happened. Now they're like, well, but we're still inside the Fed's band. Yeah, talk to a poor family from Appalachia, because the move from zero to three, that puts that family way below the poverty line.
Especially when their wages weren't moving up, even close to that.
Absolutely. And not only that, but the pension funds are also massively affected. Their whole investment strategy changed dramatically when they're at zero inflation versus 3%. So don't tell me 3% doesn't count. And it's only post-Ukraine, when it's higher than three, that we have a problem. No, it's only post-Ukraine higher than three that the rich have a problem. But the poor have been having a problem for a long time. So I think if we could address this issue, and unfortunately, the old textbook solution is, okay, well, we raise interest rates. But remember, we're at a point in history where we'd outsource all the manufacturing and production to China. We decided that software was the only thing that mattered. Remember, Mark Andreessen wrote that article saying software eats the world. So venture capital firms would only invest in software companies. And I know this as a former manufacturer of robotics and autonomous vehicles and aerial drones, right? I was making hardware. People are like, we're not going to invest in hardware because the Chinese can replicate that. So we lost all that. And now, because of the sharp break with China, we need to make stuff again. Now Andreessen says, oh, we should make stuff again. We should finance that. Yes. Okay. But it means there's a lag on our ability to pull together all these resources in a way that would actually pay people. And again, we have this view that, well, you can't make robotics and automation unless you went to Stanford and have a PhD in AI. And you're like, no, you don't. You don't need any of those things. What you do need are people who have been playing around with motorcycle engines and tractor engines and who know how to make broken cars work, because that can be translated. So bottom line is, a lot of this problem has to do with the attitude of our authorities and a disregard for the impact on the class of people who have the least voice. And we're now seeing that result. But again, I think this can be changed. We can fix this in lots of different ways. We just have to acknowledge that it's real instead of pretending that it isn't.
I think we all know something's changed, even if you're a beneficiary of the last 20 years. And I was, I don't want to deny that. I did well over that period. I had ups and downs, but on the whole, I did well. I grew up on a sheep farm in rural Vermont. I remember my parents on food stamps for a few years. We were poor, not dirt poor, but it was hard. Sure. And I went to a state school. I was able to pay for school by working through college. I got some grants. I got a little bit of debt, not a lot. And I was able to pay it off a few years later. Like, that's the quintessential American story.
Yeah. But that's broken now.
That doesn't exist anymore.
So, but let's talk about that for a minute. So I have a theory on this. Everybody says the problem is the split between the rich and the poor in terms of the ownership of the wealth. I think we've always had that split. I'm not saying I condone it. I'm just saying it's been around from the beginning of time. I think the problem is the elevator is not working.
Yes.
And by that, I mean, it used to be like my dad's generation. Like, my dad is the son of poor immigrants. They had nothing. They came from Sweden. My grandmother was 16. She got a job as a seamstress only because she basically said, yes, I can sew, when she had never actually seen a sewing machine. So, and my grandfather was a painter, a house painter, because he was an artist but couldn't make a living as an artist. So he was painting houses. And their kid, my dad, goes from that background to being on scholarship at Yale, at Oxford, working for the president of the United States when he's 27 years old. How does that happen? And the answer is because in those days, we had vastly more social mobility based on merit. And we had ways of pulling in people like my dad, who were just wicked smart, not because of where they were born. Some people are really smart. And so today, I think this is also a function of inflation, because when you throw so much money into the system, then the demand for everything gets chased up. And we always talk about demand for a loaf of bread, but also the demand for education. And so the cost of education kept going up. The willingness to fund others who didn't have money was actually going down. You saw this with the Hollywood scandals of people paying to get their kid into a great school. That's a symptom of this problem. And also the huge, the closing of the entryway, that unless you have exactly the right credentials to get through this door, then you're not getting through this door. This is all exclusionary. And one of the trends that I find really heartening is that a lot of companies in America, particularly regional, large, medium-sized businesses, so, not your Fortune 500s, but real companies that generate genuine unimpaired cash flow, that do real business, increasingly they've been saying, these business school graduates, they come and they think their first job should be assistant to the chief executive and the second job should be chief executive, right? It's a kind of sense of entitlement that I spent this much money and I worked this hard and I went to Harvard and blah, blah, blah. So, of course, I should be on that track. And they are reverting to a very old model, which is, let's hire high school graduates, not even college, Let's hire high school graduates and let's offer them that we will train them in the company because the school system isn't even providing the skills that we need. They may have a degree, but we got to train them again from scratch. So let's bring them in and then we'll say we'll pay for your college education. So you can do that part time while you work here, but we train you first with our priorities. And so it's kind of the old fashioned apprenticeship system that the whole German economy was always built on. And that economy has always been very sound because it was focused on small and medium sized businesses, a lot of family owned businesses, regionally rooted businesses. And that's working well. But of course, that's heretical to say to the education system, which thinks that, you know, they own the stamp of approval on whether you're employable or not. But the break in society it's causing is so severe that we've got to change this. And I'm not saying I'm not in favor of education. I'm like one of the most overeducated people around.
Of course.
It's insane. But now we're in lifelong learning. This isn't about college and graduate school anymore. This is about for the whole rest of your life, you're going to have to keep upskilling and upskilling and not just upskilling. I think lateral moving. My whole career is about making big lateral jumps. And people are like, why are you leaving being a, you know, head of foreign exchange? I was the chief currency strategist of Bankers Trust. And then I leapt into a very different direction. And I'm like, well, because it's more interesting to learn stuff. And then that helps explain how I got to where I got to. But it feels risky to make these big leaps in a world where everyone's holding you to a narrow path.
To kind of bring it all together, but you wanted to talk a little bit about the presidential race in its early days. What are your thoughts on the candidates that you're seeing?
Just to back up a little bit. So in 2015, I wrote an article where I said, I think Donald Trump can win. And just to be clear, it wasn't a preference. It was just a prediction. It was just I can see the forces aligning. And at the time, people were like, you are completely insane. This is never, ever going to happen. And then, well, it did. So today, I'm looking at it, and I think something historic and extraordinary is happening with Robert F. Kennedy. And people are like, that's insane. This cannot happen. I'm like, watch this space. So what is it that's occurring? Well, first of all, again, strangely, the whole country is choosing Trumpers or Trumpians, what do we call them? People who follow that same line of thought. So DeSantis is effectively a Trumper. He is.
Yeah, sure.
RFK is too. They're very aligned on many of their views. And in fact, he's one of the only candidates that Trump has been very complimentary of. And I do think this matters because Trump is still so popular in the United States, contrary and to the dismay of many in the country, that whoever he blesses, it will matter who he blesses. And to be, you know, back to House of Cards, to be Machiavellian about it, if I were Trump, I would also be thinking about who might give me a presidential pardon. Right? So there's a number of layers to that. But at any rate,
Well, is it also a little bit of a burn the house down move?
What?
I mean, it's pretty savage, right? Like the only person I'm going to endorse would be somebody from the other party.
Not only from the other party, but someone who has a also let's tear this house down. Now, let's go through this. What is clear is the United States in my adult lifetime, and my first president that I worked for was Ronald Reagan. I was an intern in the Reagan White House. We love electing someone you never heard of 3 years before. No one ever heard of Bill Clinton 3 years before, right? We all forget that now. We never heard, no one thought George W. Bush. They were like, are you kidding? That's like a joke. No one ever heard of Obama. They were like, who? No one ever heard or thought Trump. So we know for sure the public wants the outsider who they think can go to Washington and clean it up. Even Bush, who may come from the famous family, he was the black sheep. He was perceived as the outsider. So in each case, these are all people they think can be represent me and clean this mess up. And so that desire for the long shot that can clean this up is still there. And that is where RFK fits that bill and has the street cred as well and the credentials that most of the rest don't. But even before getting to that, there's also look at Mayor Suarez, who I've met and is incredibly brilliant and super thoughtful and definitely presidential material. He basically has all the same views as Trump as well. And so who are the most popular candidates? They're all Trumpers so far. DeSantis is proving to be not that popular. And people are leaning towards give me somebody else. I think on the president's side, I don't think that Biden is going to be the nominee because I don't think he's going to make it. And that's partly because you can see he's literally falling down. He can't read his notes. But more importantly, he's now going to be under pressure and under legal investigation because of the whole Hunter Biden story. And we know from history that any president who faces that kind of litigation risk, that just drains time and energy. I'm not even saying whether it's true or not true. It's designed to drain his time and energy. And by the way, the kind of joke in Washington, the insiders is all like, you know, this is basically getting to be elder abuse. They should just let him go to the old folks home, right? You know, but anyway, we'll see. But it just feels like he's not going to make it. And if he is up against RFK, oh my God, just watch RFK and the Joe Rogan podcast and you'll see he's just...
He's eloquent.
I mean, it's just over. We know who wins that thing. So then the next thing I'll say is technology matters. And every presidency is defined by a technology. I haven't written this yet, but I'm preparing to write a piece on my Substack column about this. So Bill Clinton and Bush, they were television presidents. And Clinton won on Saturday Night Live playing the saxophone. That was the moment, right?
Right.
You know okay. This. Obama was the first YouTube president. He was. And he raised money on this thing called the internet, which people didn't really know about before that, right? And it surprised everyone that he could raise money in $100 pieces from the general public with almost spending no money to do so. And then Trump was the Twitter president. And the Twitter presidency was particularly contentious because you were literally 120 characters. And so everything became the sound bite. It became very punchy. It became very aggressive because you were so constrained. This presidency is the podcast presidency. And you can see already the tech is changing the whole dialogue. And the Rogan JFK interview, or RFK interview, is crucial that for that, because what you see is that, first of all, you get 3 hours, like what we're doing now. You as a podcast host are giving me an incredible amount of time, space, allowing me to go into nuance, and I'm not interrupting me very much, even though I'm talking too long, you know, and, which is amazing because then I can get the flow, right? And you can choose your interviewer. So now we don't have hostile interviewers in podcast land. And you get to show off how deep and nuanced and committed and what's your history. So what's the number one political issue since the 1950s in the United States? Clean water. Everybody forgets this. And who is the only candidate that actually has cleaned up the water supply of the Hudson River and turned it from a dead zone into a live zone? I mean, no one has that credential. And we go, well, that doesn't really matter. But it's the number one issue. That's why everyone knows Aaron Brockovich, right? Why do they know? Because they care about clean water. The other thing about this is everybody says America has turned into a land of conspiracists. If that is true, guess who they're going to vote for? The conspiracy candidate. And the first thing that RFK has said he's going to do is a few things that matter to the public. And I'll finish with this. He's like, I'm going to open the JFK files. There's an interest in that. There just is. But I would say there's something bigger that people aren't paying attention to yet. He was described by Politico magazine as the most respected white man in Black America. And that is true. Partly because his family has such a record on human rights, the civil rights movement. I mean, there's just no contesting that. But also, he was a drug user in his youth, and even a heroin addict, in fact, at one point. And so he understands that world and has recovered from it, which I have to say in and of itself is very impressive. And now we're in a stage of history where this stuff is starting to be legalized for therapeutic use. And so the youth, when they hear him say he gets that it can be useful for therapy and he wouldn't be opposed to that, he's winning the youth movement. But he's also said that one of the first things he would do was free everyone from prison who's in there for having a spliff on a Friday night. And who is that? Mainly it's African-American families, unfortunately. And there's a long history to that. Were they targeted? Was this an excuse for incarceration in a system that pays states to have people in jail? We could go into all the detail, but the reality is, I think the African-American community is going to go, wait a minute, he's going to do that. Plus, he says, I believe entrepreneurs are the future. Therefore, I don't want to tax the entrepreneurs harder. I want to tax the big corporates harder. Well, every African-American and Latino family, they're all entrepreneurs because no one would hire them. So, of course, they're like, hey, this sounds like my kind of guy. And a lot of Republicans are going to go, yeah, that sounds good to me, too. A lot of Democrats are like Bill Clinton conservatives are like, yeah, let's be pro-business and have a social agenda. And finally, RFK's position on social issues, and probably the most important is abortion. He's like, I think Roe versus Wade was right. And states should be able to have their own rules. So I wouldn't interfere with that. But I don't think the federal government should be imposing blanket rules on citizens across the board. So then everyone who's a libertarian and thinks government should leave you alone once you get home, they're going to be like, eh, that kind of sounds good. So what's the big objection and why does he get trashed all the time? Well, because he picked the vaccine issue, which isn't really about vaccines. What he's really doing is saying, I don't think the pharma companies should own the regulatory process. And I don't think that they should be able to advertise, making every American feel that they're ill and only if they take something can they be better, which is actually the case with most countries. You don't see pharma advertising anywhere in the world the way you see it in the United States. And of course, that will undercut CNN and CNBC, who derive much of their income from pharma advertising. And so they have to trash RFK. But the more they do it and the more they try to ban him and not allow him to have Secret Service protection, the more popular he gets. So whether he wins or not, that voice is influencing the election, which leaves me with two little last things to say. We have not seen before what we're seeing in this presidential race. Suarez, DeSantis, and RFK are all Bitcoiners, and Suarez and RFK are environmentalists. So we have Bitcoiner, green Bitcoiners running for the presidency. And I'm just saying, one from each party, this is both sides. And I'm like, okay. And probably RFK won't even agree to go on CNN or CNBC. And why should he when he gets a bigger audience doing the podcasts that have a larger reach? And so it could be that the way this thing is won and the issues it's won on will completely take the mainstream media by surprise, just as Trump took them by surprise.
Pippa, I'm going to borrow your analogy and I'm going to call you the president of Substack. Everyone who made it this far with us and enjoyed this conversation should check your Substack out.
Listen, thank you so much. And that was just great. Love that. Love having that freedom to talk about so many interrelated issues.
If you want to dig deeper into the United States relationship with China and how China is exporting the dangerous drug fentanyl to the U.S., check out my conversation with Allison Federka.